Hey guys, welcome back. I'm Ian Laspina, and today we're going to start talking about a new early 15th century cuirass, beginning with the upper half, which is going to consist of the breastplate and hinged split backplates. So I've already done a video discussing more in depth the development of plate back defense from the late 14th into the early 15th century, so we're not going to cover all that information again, but we are going to quickly recap the specific development of this type of back defense, which is a split backplate, or modernly referred to as saloon door backplates. So this brings us back to the last quarter of the 14th century, where we start to get some kind of elusive clues and artwork suggesting that this type of backplate defense is already in development. One of the earliest depictions of this is a late 1370s bas relief of St. George and the Dragon, where we can see these very clearly centerline buckles, suggesting the closure of these two backplate pieces. What sets this apart from contemporary coat of plates designs, multi-plate construction riveted to a foundation layer, like we see on the Prague St. George, for example, is that instead of seeing the surface covered in those telltale rivets, which would secure that foundation layer to the plates, the only rivets that the artist shows us here are two very specific rivets underneath St. George's armpit, which are right where you would place the rivets for the hinges on a split backplate. Later on in the 14th century, we see on the funeral effigy of Eckhard von Rosenberg a breastplate very similarly designed like the Kerberg number 13 segmented breastplate. However, instead of continuing that construction around to the side plates, we see hinges right again underneath his armpit, suggesting the presence of hinged wings. It's not really until the early 15th century, though, that we start to see this particular configuration of split backplate become much more commonly depicted in a variety of artwork. It's also around this time that we start to see the variation with which this design could be approached. Some of these backplates are not full back defense, but rather just wings that protect a portion of the back, leaving the rest of those gaps to be protected by the underlying mail shirt. Others are much more fully developed and show a backplate that essentially covers the entirety of the back, closed down the center line with buckles. We also start to hear of documentary evidence in the early 15th century that gives us some insight into the possible period terminology of these hinged wings. John Lydgate's Troy book describes a breastplate with reredoos shut from behind, suggesting that these reredoos might be the saloon door backplates. The inventory of the Archbishop of York from the 1420s describes a breastplate in two parts with two wings. This particular one is interesting because the two parts are described separately from the two wings. It's unknown exactly what he means, but there are contemporary depictions of centerline split backplates in multi-part construction with that early 15th century innovation of the placard as well, so it could be referring to something like this. All right, so taking a look at the reproduction, this was made for me by Jeff Wasson. There'll be a link in the description below to his website if you want to take a look at more of his work. And this is, like I said at the beginning, this is only half of the cuirass. This is married to a ponce of plates or a skirt of plates that will protect the lower half of the torso that we'll take a look at in the next video. So starting from the front, we've got the breastplate itself, which we've seen before, this style of breastplate, globose form with a stop rib to help deflect weapons away from the throat. It's modeled after the specific survival from the late 14th century in the castle Kerberg. Moving around to the side, you can see where the hinges are. There are two hinges mounted internally to the breastplate and then to its respective half of the backplate design, and obviously this is what allows the entire assembly to open. Once it's open, you can see this is about as far as it opens. It doesn't really need to open any further than that because all you need to be able to do is get into it. You'll also notice here that the roll at the top of what is the wearer's right backplate kind of ends here at the last 3/4 of an inch, and that is because of overlap. So this backplate, this side, is designed to go underneath to allow the two backplates to overlap. And the reason that that's important is because if they were designed to just butt up right next to each other, edge to edge, inevitably as you're walking around and moving, these would be allowed to gap. By building in that overlap, it prevents that from occurring. The other thing you're going to notice is that when they are overlapped, the actual line down the center is not quite in the symmetrical center of the back. And we did this on purpose. Now, if that was something that bothered you, you could obviously engineer the overlap to make sure that that line is perfectly down the center. But one of the things we wanted to ensure we could do in the future is make sure that that center line is clear and unobstructed for the mounting of a buckle. Why a buckle there? Because when we look at late 14th century bassinets and early 15th century great bassinets, a very common feature is that the helmet itself has a strap coming down the center of the back, which straps to the center line of a rigid back defense. If that buckle is not directly in the center, it might put some twist on that strap, which might affect the way the helmet sits on your head. So in order to accommodate the future of a bassinet back strap, we wanted to make sure that we could mount a buckle to symmetrical center on the back. So that's why we shifted the line a little bit to the wearer's right side. All right, so now let's put this thing on. All right, so here is what I will wear underneath. You can see that I've got my arming doublet on, a pair of mail sleeves, and then my mail collar, mail standard. Notice how the mail sleeves leave big gaps in the center of the chest and the center of the back. But this coverage is going to be, or lack of coverage, is going to be mitigated by the type of torso protection. So in my previous configuration of armor, where I just wore a breastplate, I had to wear a full mail shirt because I had nothing in the back. But now with these back plates, you'll see that the gap in the center of the chest and the gap in the center of the back disappear as soon as the armor goes on, which is a nice thing because I don't have to wear a full mail shirt anymore. You get to get a little bit of weight savings there from reducing the amount of mail on your body, and I find it a lot more comfortable to wear the mail sleeves. The important part is that your torso protection should be able to support the choice of wearing less mail. You don't want to have any areas that are just protected by a very thin layer of an unpadded arming doublet where a sword point can easily penetrate. Now I'm having my lovely assistant help me get into this armor. Obviously, there's no way I could put this on by myself. I could never reach the centerline buckles and straps. And you'll see that the tension is very important, especially at the waist there when this marries up to the rest of the cuirass, which we'll take a look at in the next video. So now I've got it on. You can see that all those gaps in coverage are now gone. When I raise my arm, you'll see that the lower edge of the mail sleeve stays tucked into the cuirass. It does blouse out a little bit, which you're going to notice here from the back view. To mitigate that, I could experiment with tacking it down to the arming doublet, or perhaps adding points from corner to corner in the back of the sleeves. But the important thing really is that it doesn't spill out all the way, opening you up directly to the arming doublet. And you'll see here, range of motion is not really affected. I still have full range of motion of my arms. I can touch my elbows across my chest. The bottom of the breastplate terminates just below the short rib and just above the crest of the ilium on the pelvis, so right in the natural waist where there are no bones. All right, so in the next video, like I said, we're going to look at the rest of the cuirass, which is the skirt of plates or pont of plates, and see how this entire configuration works together to protect the entire torso. Thank you guys for watching. I hope you guys learned something. Hopefully you enjoyed the video. If you did, please give me a thumbs up. Subscribe if you haven't already. Thank you very much to my patrons on Patreon for helping support the channel, and we'll see you guys in the next video. Thanks for watching. Bye.